Hi, assalamu alaikum. Okay, this will be the last part for buck converter. So in this part, we will continue the analysis in finding the passive component for the buck converter. We're going to find the value for the inductor, the value for capacitor, and also the we will continue on the current analysis in finding the maximum and the minimum induct current. Okay, so let us proceed. So in this slide, the buck converter will be analyzed in CCM, continuous conduction mode, and also we'll touch on the operation of buck converter in DCM, discontinuous conduction mode, before we end by giving a sum up of this topic, this type of converter. Right, so let us proceed next. Okay, so previously in the previous video, I did mention that what we call the equation in finding the duty cycle for buck converter, which is D, will be equals to your output voltage V naught over your input voltage Vs. So that is the equation. So how that equation of duty cycle is coming from, you can refer to the previous video. I did write all the derivation in finding the equation for the duty cycle. So as for this video, we will continue in further the analysis in steady state analysis. Okay. So in steady state, one of the assumptions that we make is that we assume the capacitor current is zero. If you refer back to the buck converter circuit, you can see that we have your inductor current will be equals to IC plus I naught. Okay, so when we assume the capacitor current equals to zero here, so we can know that inductor current will be equals to your output current. So by using Ohm's law, your output current I naught will be equals to V naught over R. So for buck converter, your average inductor current IL will be equals to I naught, which is your output current. Okay, for other type of DC to DC converter, it might not have the same assumption as this one over here. Okay, so please bear in mind, only buck converter average inductor current will be equals to your output current. Alright, and then let us proceed to the next one. Okay. So once we have defined the average inductor current IL, so now we need to find the maximum and the minimum inductor current. So we are referring to this waveform over here. This is the typical waveform of inductor current, okay, whereby it will start with the positive value over here and it will rise up. Okay, during this time, your switch will be turned on, your diode will be reverse bias, and then until it reach the maximum value of inductor current, and then it will go down. And during this time, remember, your switch is off. This is when the inductor release all the stored energy and the diode is become forward bias. Alright, so this is for one cycle period of time. Yeah, okay. And then the top waveform over here is your your inductor voltage. Okay, you can see that same. Eh? This is when your switch is on, your diode become reverse bias, which is I put it as RB. This is when your switch is off, your diode become forward bias or FB. Okay, alright. And the duration, remember that this will be equals to DT. Duration for the T on, and the duration for T off over here will be equals to 1 minus T times T. Okay, so T off will be equals to 1 minus T times T. T on will be equals to DT. Alright, so how to find, okay, now next step, we need to find the value for the maximum and the minimum inductor current. Okay, alright, so from this figure over here, okay, let us draw in the next slide. Oh, where is the next slide? Okay, there will be an empty slide after this. Okay, so we will redraw back this waveform over here. Okay. Alright, for you to understand how we actually get the value, the equation for the maximum and minimum inductor current. Okay, so from the waveform just now, okay, we will have this maximum inductor current and minimum inductor current over here. So IL max and IL min. Okay, so this equation over here, I will explain in the next slide. Alright, okay, we will continue and draw the waveform of inductor current. So we have 2 points, the minimum inductor current and the maximum inductor current, which is equals to the peak of your inductor current waveform. Okay, about half of this waveform here lies your average inductor current IL, which is will be equals to your I naught. Okay, and so you need to find the information in order to find the value for your IL max. Once you find your IL max, then you'll be able to find your IL min easily. So in order for you to find the value for your IL max, you need to have more information in order to relate with the in finding the equation for IL max. So we have this. IL max will be equals to IL plus the one that I put in the question mark over here. Alright. And then we have this delta IL, which is the duration of the minimum and between the maximum and the minimum of your inductor current. And this, you can see that from this waveform over here, half of your delta IL, which is this one here, is being covered, okay, by your average inductor current. So you have another half of your delta IL. So you can conclude that your IL max will be equals to IL plus delta IL over 2. Okay. So you need to find what is your delta IL. So if you refer back to the previous video, we have two equations of delta IL. So one is that your delta IL when your switch is on will be equals to Vs minus Vout over L multiplied by dt. And another one, delta IL when your switch is off will be equals to negative V naught over L multiplied by 1 minus T times T. So you can choose either one, okay, and substitute inside this IL max equation. But remember, in choosing either of this equation, you need to choose with the key point is least unknown parameter. Yeah, so for the least unknown parameter, so if let's say that we are referring to the first one here, you have one unknown Vs, two unknown V naught, three unknown L, four unknown, and five unknown parameter, okay, D and T here. If you are referring to the second delta IL equation here, you have one unknown V naught, two unknown VL, three unknown your duty cycle, and four unknown is your time, which is you have four unknown parameter. So if you compare this between these two delta IL equation, obviously this one here will have the least unknown parameter. So we We will choose this delta IL equation and substitute inside your IL max equation. But you need to ignore the sign over here. Just take the equation. Yeah? So when we substitute back, so your delta, sorry, your IL max will be equals to delta IL, average inductor current, plus V naught over L. Remember, ignore the sign. Eh? V naught over L multiplied by 1 minus T times T. Okay, and your average inductor current will be equals to V naught over R plus this one over here. Okay, we take out the V naught out. Okay, it will be equals to V naught multiplied by 1 plus 1 over R plus 1 minus T times T over L. So you will get the equation in finding the value for your IL max equation. For your IL min, you can just use the same equation. It's just that you change the sign here from plus to minus. So V naught over R minus V naught over L multiplied by 1 minus T times T. Then you will get your IL min equation, your minimum inductor current here. Okay, these two equation over here. Alright. Okay, so we proceed to the next one. Right, okay, and then we have from the slide, the written slide over there, we already finished the analysis in finding the current, which is we'll be able to find the average inductor current IL. We'll be able to find the maximum inductor current and as well as the minimum inductor current. So now, basically, we already finished the analysis with regards to voltage and current. So we will proceed the analysis in finding the passive component in the circuit, which is the value for your inductor and also the value for your capacitor. So we will start in by finding the value for your inductor first. So the first what we call way to find the value for your inductor is by finding what we call as minimum value of inductor, or what we call as boundary inductor. Okay, so your L min will be equals to minimum value of inductor, or sometimes it called as boundary inductor. Okay, how to find this L min? So one of the way is that by using IL min equation. So we need to set IL min equation equals to 1, equals to 0, which is this is the boundary condition. Okay, so what does it mean by boundary condition is that this value of L min, it will determine the boundary between CCM, between CCM and DCM. So this minimum value of your inductor, L min, will determine the boundary between continuous and discontinuous conduction mode. Okay. So, for the previous, if you are referring to the previous slide, so your IL min will be equals to your V naught 1 over R minus 1 minus T over 2LF here. Okay, previously in the previous slide, I put 1 minus T times T. So, T, which is this one over here, Okay, so that T will be equals to 1 minus your switching frequency. Okay, right, so we need to set this equation equals to 0. So 0 will be equals to V0 over R. So you need to rearrange the equation so that you'll be able to make it L as the things that you need to find. Okay, so V0 equals to 1 minus T over 2 L. Why is that? Okay, 2 LFS equals to V0 over R. Okay, so we need to take out the L. So L will be equals to, okay, V0 over 1 minus T 2. Okay, just follow the rest. Okay, and then we bring down the V0 there. Okay. What else? Okay, V0 over R. Oh, okay, we need to put the R there. Here. Okay. Like that. So this V0 here will be cancelled out. So it will leave you your L mean will be equals to 1 minus D multiplied by R over your 2 switching frequency. 2 multiply switching frequency, yeah. Okay, so this is the value, the equation in finding the minimum value of your inductor. Alright, so there is another way to find the value for inductor. I will show you in the next slide. Okay, alright, so this, okay, next we go for the second value of your passive component, which is we need to find the value for your capacitor. Okay, in this buck converter circuit, we assume the capacitor to be very large value. Okay, why is that? We need to assume the capacitor value is large because we want to maintain a almost constant output voltage. Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay, normally for the capacitor, it will influence by what we call as the variation of your output voltage, or what we call as ripple. Okay, so this is, okay, the waveform of your output voltage. Okay, this is when you need to zoom in order to get this kind of waveform, or sometimes you will get a bit of sharp edges of the waveform here. So this is the ripple, yeah. Okay, so this, the bottom one will be your V0 min, and the top one will be your V0 max. Okay, this line over here, the dotted line here, will be your V0 average. Okay, so in order to find the, let's say we want to know what is the ripple, which is, the ripple is defined by the variation of your output voltage, which is, so your ripple, it will determine, what we call define like this, which is delta V0 over V0. V0 here is your average, yeah. So your delta V0 will be V0 max minus V0 min over your V0 average. And normally the value here, which is the ripple, defined as ripple, should not be that high. So if let's say that your ripple is quite high, which means that your capacitor does not function at it supposed to be. Okay, normally we try to make it less than 5%. So we define in term of percent. Yeah? So once you get the value, you multiply by 100, you will get in term of percentage. So we need to make sure we need to limit the ripple less than 5%. Okay. Right. So from the waveform over there in finding the ripple, we need to relate in order to find the value for your capacitor. Okay, the value for your capacitor. So how to find the value of your capacitor? We will need to use what we call as charge equation. Okay, how to spell equation? Okay, charge equation. So which is Q will be equals to C multiplied by V naught. So from this equation, so this is all the derivation here. Okay, so the one that you need to know is this value of the capacitor over here. So this is the equation in finding the capacitor for buck converter, which is C will be equals to 1 minus D over 8 multiplied by L multiplied by your, this one is your output voltage ripple multiplied by your switching frequency over 2. Okay, so don't worry. Normally during your test or during your final exam, equation, all equation will be given unless I need you to do the derivation, then I will not give you this final equation over here. Okay? Alright. So now we go for this the next slide, which is what we call as design consideration for DC to DC converter. It applies to all type of DC to DC converter, not just buck converter. This design configuration also apply for boost and buck boost converter. Okay, so this line over here will not be repeated in boost and buck boost. Okay, right. So, okay, basically for DC to DC converter, it will influence by the selection of your switching frequency, the selection of your inductor, and also the selection of your output voltage ripple, the percentage of your output voltage ripple. So these are the three things that will affect the performance of your DC to DC converter. Okay, these three components will ensure that you will get a continuous current throughout the operating condition, and also you'll be able to get a smooth or what we call as a clean output voltage. Okay, so for the first point, as you increase your switching frequency, okay, the minimum value of inductor and minimum value of your capacitor will decrease. So which is, if you increase your switching frequency, your L, the value of your L and value of your capacitor C will decrease. Okay, why is that? You can refer back to the equation and you can see that in each of these equation there is a switching frequency over there. So once the switching frequency is situated at the denominator side, so as you increase the denominator side, obviously you will get a smaller output value. Okay, however, so which is, this is a good thing, yeah? Once you increase the switching frequency, the value for your inductor and capacitor will be reduced. So in terms of cost, you will get a more cost effective. But if when you increase the switching frequency, you need to expect that the switching losses will be higher. You will increase the switching losses. Once you increase the switching losses, which means that it will contribute to the losses to your converter. And once you calculate the efficiency of your converter, obviously the efficiency will be dropped. Okay. And also by having a high switching frequency, it will the more heat will be produced. So when more heat, it will degrade the switch converter efficiency, and when there is more heat, you need to have more larger protection, which is in the case of heat sink. Okay, So what are the typical range of switching frequency that normally used? Okay, which is the losses is not that high, but yet you'll be able to get all almost minimum value of inductor and capacitor. Okay, one of the what we call the commonly a selection of switching frequency is that your switching frequency must be higher than 20 kilohertz. Okay, this is to avoid audio noise. Okay, and it can go up to 1 megahertz. Okay, so the range will be from 20 kilohertz up to 1 megahertz. Okay, but normally the switching frequency will be keep at 50 hertz, 50 kilohertz, which is 50 kilohertz switching frequency, which is you'll be able to get rid of the audio noise, and yet the switching losses will not be that high. Okay, which is your switching frequency equals to 50 kilohertz. All right. Okay, and then the next point is that with regards to the sizing of inductor. Okay, previously in the previous slide, okay, we did find the equation in finding the minimum value of inductor, which is L min. So this L min will determine the boundary between the CCM and DCM. Okay, all right. Okay, and then they ask another consideration in finding the value for the inductor.